as you'll see, I'm going to be returning to some quite classical questions in social theory, questions about the nature of capitalism, which unfortunately were kind of fell off the radar screen for a while, but clearly in the wake of the 2008 crisis are, I think, very much back on the agenda, and rightly so. So I would say that the current sense of crisis, a very widespread sense of crisis, a multidimensional sense of crisis, crisis in economy, in ecology, in politics, and in society more broadly, is prompting many critical theorists to revisit this question of capitalism. And as I say, I salute that return to core issues in social theory after this unfortunate period of neglect. Nevertheless, I want to insist that received understandings of capitalism are not adequate to 21st century conditions, and so I'm going to try to re-examine this basic theoretical question: how is capitalism best conceptualized? As an economic system, as a form of ethical life, or as an institutionalized social order? To try to answer that question, I'm going to integrate what I believe will be to many of you some relatively familiar concepts from Marx with some newer insights from feminist, ecological, and political theorizing. The result will be an expanded conception of capitalism, which in my view is better able to accommodate the multiplicity of crisis tendencies and social struggles that characterize the present time. So, without further ado, the question, what is capitalism? What's the best way to conceptualize it? Seems to cry out for an essential definition of some sort, a set of core features that distinguishes capitalist societies from non-capitalist societies. Now, it's true that students of the so-called varieties of capitalism school might doubt that there can be any such core definition. But I want to say that it makes no sense to talk about the varieties of capitalism unless they share some common underlying features in virtue of which they are all varieties of capitalism. So unless we can say something, however general, about what capitalism is, we won't be able to determine whether the present crisis is indeed a crisis of capitalism, or as opposed to something else. Maybe it's only a crisis of neoliberal capitalism and not capitalism per se. Anyway, I'm going to try to bite the bullet and try to elucidate some core elements of capitalism that I believe can be specified in the abstract, apart from all the many different concrete forms in which they can be instantiated. The core features I'm going to propose are, as I said, quite classical and will be familiar to those of you who know Marx. So my approach is going to appear at first sight to be very orthodox, but I intend to de-orthodoxize it very shortly by showing how these classic core features presuppose some other things which constitute their background conditions of possibility. Whereas Marx found his core features of capitalism by looking beneath the sphere of exchange to what he called the hidden abode of production, I'm going to seek production's conditions of possibility behind that sphere in realms that are more hidden still. Okay, but that's getting ahead of myself. Let me begin first by elaborating four core features of a capitalist society as viewed from a relatively orthodox perspective. The first is private property in the means of production, which presupposes a class division between the owners and the producers. This division arises as a result of the breakup of a previous social unity in which most people, however differently situated, had some access to the means of subsistence and to the means of production. Access, in other words, to food, shelter, and clothing, and to tools, land, and work without having to go through labor markets. So this division between owners and producers presupposes the enclosure of common social resources, which then become the private property of a relatively small group of individuals. Now that leads us directly to the second core feature of capitalism, the free labor market. Because the others, that is the vast majority, no longer have sufficient direct access to the means of sustenance and the means of production to meet their basic needs. Suddenly, they have to go through a rather peculiar song and dance in order to get work, to get what they need to continue living and raising their families. The important thing is just how bizarre, how unnatural, if you like, how historically anomalous and specific this free labor market institution is. Let me remind you, following Marx, that labor here is free in a double sense. First, in a sense that pertains to legal status. The producers are not enslaved and serfed, entailed, or otherwise bound to a given place or to a particular master. Rather, they are mobile and able then to enter into a labor contract. But second, they are free, as I just said, from access to the means of subsistence and the means of production. They are bereft of customary use rights in land and in tools, hence they lack the resources. They are freed of the resources and entitlements that could permit them to abstain from the labor market. So their freedom in the first sense is intimately connected to their vulnerability to compulsion in the second sense. Next is the equally strange song and dance of what Marx called self-expanding value, which is the third core feature of capitalism I want to invoke. Capitalism is peculiar in having an objective system thrust or directionality, namely the accumulation of capital. In principle, everything the owners do qua owners, qua capitalists, is aimed at expanding their capital. Not to expand is to die, to fall prey, at least in a competitive situation, to one's competitors. So this is not a form of life in which the owners are simply enjoying themselves and having a grand old time. Like the producers, they too stand under a peculiar systemic compulsion. And everyone's efforts to satisfy their needs are indirect, harnessed to something else that assumes priority. That is, an overriding imperative inscribed in an impersonal system, namely capital's own drive to unending self-expansion. Marx, I believe, is absolutely brilliant on this point. In a capitalist society, he says, capital itself becomes the subject. Human beings are its pawns, reduced to figuring out how they can get what they need in the interstices by feeding the beast. The fourth feature that I want to mention specifies the distinctive role of markets in capitalist society. Markets have existed throughout human history, including in non-capitalist societies. What distinguishes their functioning in capitalism, I claim, is two things. First, markets serve in capitalist societies to allocate the major direct inputs to commodity production. Understood in classical political economy as factors of production, these major inputs were originally identified as land, labor, and capital. So, in addition to utilizing markets to allocate labor, capitalism also uses them to allocate real estate, whether we're talking about commercial or agriculture or residential real estate, capital goods, that is machinery and plant, raw materials, mineral and agricultural, and money. That is cash, credit, investment, capital, and all the paper forms that that takes, including most recently derivatives, as well as stocks and bonds and so on. Now, insofar as it allocates these productive inputs through market mechanisms, capitalism transforms them into commodities. It is, then, in Piero Sraffa's arresting phrase, a system for the production of commodities by means of commodities, although it's one that also relies, as we'll see very shortly, on a background of non-commodities. But there is also a second key function that markets assume in a capitalist society, and that is they determine how society's surplus will be invested. By surplus, I mean the collective fund of social energies, excluding those required to reproduce a given form of life and to replenish what is used up in the course of living it. How a society uses its surplus capacities is absolutely central, raising fundamental questions about how people want to live, where they choose to invest their collective energies, how they propose to balance, as we say today, productive work versus family life, leisure, and other activities, how they aspire to relate to non-human nature, how much and what they aim to leave to future generations. Capitalist societies tend to leave the bulk of such decisions to market forces. This is, for me, perhaps their most consequential and perverse feature, this handing over of the most important matters to an apparatus for reckoning monetized value. It is closely related to my third core feature, that is, to capital's inherent but blind directionality, the self-expansion or expansionary process through which it constitutes itself as the subject of history, displacing the human beings who have made it and turning them into its servants. Now, by stressing these two roles of markets, I aim to take my distance from the widely held view that capitalism propels the ever-increasing commodification of life as such. That view leads down a blind alley, I think, to dystopian fantasies of a totally commodified world. Not only do such fantasies neglect the emancipatory aspects of markets, of which there are some, but they overlook the fact, stressed by Emmanuel Wallerstein, that capitalism has generally operated on the basis of what Wallerstein calls semi-proletarianized households. Under these arrangements, which allow owners to pay workers less, many households derive a significant portion of their sustenance from sources other than cash wages, including self-provisioning, for example, the garden plot or taking in sowing and so on, informal reciprocity, mutual aid, in-kind transactions, and state transfers, welfare benefits, social services, public goods. Such arrangements leave a significant portion of activities and goods outside the purview of the market. They are not mere residual holdovers from pre-capitalist times, nor are they on their way out. These kinds of arrangements were intrinsic to Fordism, which was able to promote working class consumerism in the countries of the core only by way of semi-proletarianized households that combined male employment with female homemaking, as well as, of course, by inhibiting the development of commodity consumption in the periphery. Semi-proletarianization is even more pronounced in neoliberalism, which has built an entire accumulation strategy by expelling billions of people from the official economy into informal gray zones from which capital siphons off value. As we shall see, this sort of so-called primitive accumulation is an ongoing process from which capital profits and on which it relies. So the point here is that marketized aspects of capitalist societies coexist with non-marketized aspects. This is no fluke or empirical contingency, in my view, but a feature built into capitalism's DNA. In fact, coexistence is too weak a term to capture the relation between marketized and non-marketized aspects of a capitalist society. A better term would be functional imbrication, or perhaps still better and more simply, dependence. Karl Polanyi helps us understand why. Society, he tells us, cannot be commodities all the way down. Actually, that's my paraphrase of his point. The point is that markets depend for their very existence on non-marketized social relations which supply their background conditions of possibility. And that's the point I want to elaborate now. So far, as I said, I've been elaborating a fairly orthodox definition of capitalism based on four core features that seem to be economic. I have effectively followed Marx in looking behind the common sense perspective, which focuses on market exchange, to the so-called hidden abode of production. Now, however, I want to look behind that hidden abode to what is more hidden still. My claim is that Marx's account of capitalist production only makes sense when we start to fill in its background conditions of possibility. So my next question is, what must exist behind these core features in order for them to be possible? Now, Marx himself, interestingly, broaches a question of this very sort near the end of volume one of Das Kapital, in the chapter on so-called primitive or original accumulation. Here he asks, where did capital come from? How did private property in the means of production come to exist? And how did the producers become separated from them? In the preceding chapters, he had already laid bare capitalism's economic logic in abstraction from its background conditions of possibility. These latter were taken for granted, assumed as simply given. But it turns out that there is a whole backstory about where capital itself comes from, a rather violent story of theft, dispossession, and expropriation. Moreover, as David Harvey has stressed, this backstory is not only located in the past, at the so-called origins of capitalism. Expropriation is an ongoing, if unofficial, mechanism of accumulation, which continues alongside the official one, the mechanism of exploitation, which is Marx's front story, so to speak. Now, this move from the front story of exploitation to the back story of expropriation constitutes a major epistemic shift, which casts everything that went before in a different light. It's analogous, by the way, to the move that Marx made earlier, to which I've already referred. I mean the move near the beginning of Volume 1, when he invites us to leave behind the sphere of market exchange and the perspective of bourgeois common sense associated with it, for that hidden abode of production, which affords a more critical perspective. As a result of that first move, we discovered a dirty secret. Accumulation proceeds by means of exploitation. Capital expands, in other words, not by the exchange of equivalents, as the market perspective suggests, but rather precisely through its opposite, through the non-compensation of a portion of workers' labor time. Similarly, when we move at the volume's end from exploitation to expropriation, we discover an even dirtier secret. Behind the sublimated coercion of wage labor lie overt violence and outright theft. In other words, Marx's elaboration of capitalism's economic logic, which constitutes most of Volume 1, is not the last word. It's followed by a move to another perspective, the dispossession perspective, as Harvey calls it. This move to what is hidden behind the hidden abode is also a move to history and to what I'm calling the background conditions for the possibility of exploitation. Now, I believe that there are some other equally momentous epistemic shifts that are implied in Marx's account of capitalism, but not developed by him. These moves to abodes that are even more hidden are still in need of conceptualization. They need to be written up in new volumes of Capital, if you like, if we are to develop an adequate understanding of 21st century capitalism. One of these is the epistemic shift from commodity production to social reproduction, that is, to the forms of provisioning, caregiving, and interacting that produce and maintain social bonds, sometimes called care, affective labor, or in a different paradigm, including one that David is partial to, subjectivation. This activity forms capitalism's human subjects, sustaining them as embodied natural beings, while also constituting them as social beings, forming their habitus and the socio-ethical substance, or Sittlichkeit, in which they move. Central here is the work of socializing the young, building communities, and producing and reproducing the shared meanings, affective dispositions, and horizons of value that underpin social cooperation, including the forms of cooperation cum domination that characterize commodity production. In capitalist societies, much, though not all, of this activity goes on outside the market, in households, neighborhoods, civil society associations, and a host of public institutions, including schools and childcare centers. And much, though not all of it, does not take the form of wage labor. Yet social reproductive activity is absolutely necessary to the existence of waged work, to the accumulation of surplus value, and so to the functioning of capitalism as such. Wage labor could not exist, after all, let alone be exploited, in the absence of housework, child raising, schooling, affective care, and a host of other activities that produce new generations of workers, replenish existing generations, and maintain social bonds and shared understandings. Much like original or primitive accumulation, therefore, social reproduction is an indispensable background condition for the possibility of capitalist production. Structurally, moreover, the division between social reproduction and commodity production is central to capitalism, indeed is an artifact of it. As feminists have stressed, the distinction is thoroughly gendered, with reproduction associated with women and production associated with men. Historically, the split between so-called productive waged work and unwaged reproductive labor has underpinned modern capitalist forms of women's subordination. Like that between owners and workers, this division too rests on the breakup of a previous unity. In this case, what was shattered was a world in which women's work, although distinguished from men, was nevertheless visible and publicly acknowledged, an integral part of the social universe. With capitalism, by contrast, reproductive labor is split off, relegated to a separate private sphere where its social importance is obscured. And of course, in a world where money is a primary medium of power, the fact of its being unpaid seals the matter. Those who do this work are structurally subordinate to those who earn cash wages, even as their work also supplies some necessary preconditions for wage labor. Now, in the 20th century, this division between production and reproduction mutated as some aspects of social reproduction were transformed into public services, deprivatized but not commodified. Today, the division is mutating again, as neoliberalism is simultaneously demanding retrenchment of public provision and thus reprivatizing or recommodifying some previously decommodified things, while also recruiting women into low-paid wage labor. And when you put those two things together, you get an enormous amount of pressure on this whole aspect of social reproduction, which is turning this background condition for capital accumulation into a major flashpoint of capitalist crisis. But this is not all. I want to consider, in addition, two other equally momentous shifts in epistemic perspective, which direct us to other hidden abodes. The first is best embodied in eco-socialist thought, which foregrounds another of capitalism's conditions of possibility. Just as Marx, Harvey, and one should add Rosa Luxemburg have revealed the backstory of capital's reliance on original and ongoing dispossession, and just as feminists have disclosed the backstory of capital's dependence on women's unwaged labor of social reproduction, so eco-socialist thinkers are now writing another backstory about capitalism's free riding on nature. This story concerns capital's annexation of nature, both as a source of inputs to production and as a sink to absorb the latter's waste. Nature here is made into a resource for capital, one whose value is simultaneously presupposed and disavowed. Expropriated without compensation or replenishment, treated as costless in capital's accounts, but implicitly assumed to be infinite, nature's capacity to support life and renew itself constitutes yet another necessary background condition for commodity production and capital accumulation. And of course, need I add that it is also indispensable in sustaining all of our dramatis personae, owners, producers, reproducers, and expropriated or colonized subjects, none of whom could exist without it. Structurally, then, capitalism assumes, and indeed I would argue inaugurates, a newly sharpened division between a natural realm conceived as a free, unproduced supply of raw material available for appropriation, and an economic realm conceived as a sphere of value produced by and for human beings. Along with this goes a hardening of the pre-existing distinction between the human, seen as spiritual, socio-cultural, and historical, and non-human nature, seen as material, objectively given, and ahistorical. The sharpening of this distinction, too, rests on the breakup of a previous world in which the rhythms of social life were adapted in many respects to those of non-human nature. Capitalism brutally separated human beings from those latter rhythms, conscripting them into industrial manufacturing powered by fossil fuels and into profit-driven agriculture bulked up by chemical fertilizers, introducing what Marx called a metabolic rift. It inaugurated the Anthropocene, that is, an entirely new geological era in which human activity decisively impacts the Earth's ecosystems and atmosphere. After three centuries of such activity, capped by neoliberalism's current assault on what remains of the ecological commons, the natural conditions of capital accumulation have now become another central node of capitalist crisis. Finally, let us consider one last major epistemic shift, which points to capitalism's political conditions of possibility. Its reliance on public powers to establish and enforce its constitutive norms. Capitalism is inconceivable, after all, in the absence of a legal framework that underpins private enterprise and market exchange. Its front story depends crucially on public powers to guarantee property rights, enforce contracts, adjudicate disputes, quell anti-capitalist rebellions, and maintain, in the language of the US Constitution, the full faith and credit of the money supply that constitutes capital's lifeblood. Historically, the public powers in question have mostly been lodged in territorial states, including those that operated as colonial powers. It was the legal systems of such states that established the contours of seemingly depoliticized arenas within which private actors could pursue their economic interests free from overt political interference on the one hand, and from patronage obligations derived from kinship on the other. Likewise, it was territorial states that mobilized the so-called legitimate force to put down resistance to the expropriations through which capitalist property relations were originated and sustained. Finally, it was such states that nationalized and underwrote money. Historically, we might say the state constituted the capitalist economy. Now here, we encounter another major structural division that is constitutive of capitalist society. That is the division between polity and economy. With this division comes the institutional differentiation of public power from private power, of political from economic coercion, of the noisy, strident compulsion of armed force from what Marx called the silent compulsion of capital. Like the other core divisions we've discussed, those between owners and workers and on the one hand, and between producers and reproducers on the other, this one too arises as a result of the breakup of a previous unity. In this case, what was dismantled was a social world in which economic and political power were effectively fused, as, for example, in feudal society, which vested control over labor, land, and military force in the same institution of lordship and vassalage. In capitalist society, by contrast, as Ellen Wood has elegantly shown, economic power and political power are split apart. Each is assigned its own sphere, its own medium and modus operandi. But that's not all. Capitalism's front story also has political conditions of possibility at the geopolitical level. What is at issue here is the organization of the broader space in which territorial states are embedded. Now, this is a space in which capital moves quite easily, given its expansionist thrust. But its ability to operate across borders depends on international law, brokered agreements among great powers, and supranational governance regimes, which partially pacify, in a capital-friendly way, a realm that is often imagined as a state of nature. Throughout its history, capitalism's front story has depended on the military and organizational capacities of a succession of global hegemons, which, as Giovanni Arrighi has taught us, sought to foster accumulation on a progressively expanding scale within the framework of a multi-state system. So here we find some other structural divisions that are constitutive of capitalist society, the so-called Westphalian division between the domestic and the international on the one hand, and the imperialist division between core and periphery on the other, both premised on the more fundamental division between an increasingly global capitalist economy organized as a world system, again, Wallerstein's phrase, and a political world organized as an international system of territorial states. Now, these divisions, too, are currently mutating as neoliberalism is increasingly hollowing out the political capacities on which capital has historically relied at both the state and geopolitical levels. As a result of this hollowing out, capitalism's political conditions of possibility are also now a major site and flashpoint of crisis, both at the state level, regional level, like that of the EU, and at the global level. Well, much more could and should be said on each of these points, but I hope that the general thrust of my argument so far is clear. In filling out my initial account of capitalism, I've tried to show that its economic foreground core features depend on non-economic background conditions. What makes possible an economic system defined by private property and the means of production, the accumulation of self-expanding value, markets in free labor and in other major inputs to commodity production, as well as market allocation of social surplus, are three major sets of background conditions concerned respectively with social reproduction, the Earth's ecology, and political power. To understand capitalism, therefore, we need to relate its front story to these three backstories. We need to connect the Marxian perspective to feminist, ecological, and political theoretical perspectives, by which I mean both state theoretical, colonial, post-colonial, and transnational perspectives. Okay, what sort of animal is capitalism on this account? The picture I've been elaborating here differs importantly from the familiar idea that capitalism is an economic system. Granted, it may have looked at first sight as if the core features I identified were economic, but that appearance proved to be misleading. It became clear in the course of the discussion that these are not features of a capitalist economy, but features of a capitalist society. The peculiarity of capitalist society is that it treats its central defining and structuring social relations as if they were economic and pertained to a separate subsystem of society and economy, but that's an appearance. We've quickly found it necessary to talk about the non-economic background conditions that enabled such a system to exist. And I concluded that those background conditions must not be airbrushed out of the picture, but must be conceptualized and theorized as part of our conception of capitalism. So capitalism is something larger than an economy. Likewise, the picture I've been sketching differs from the view of capitalism as a distorted form of ethical life characterized by pervasive commodification, monetization, and reification. In that view, as articulated most famously in Lukács's celebrated essay, Reification and the Consciousness of the Proletariat, the commodity form colonizes all of life, stamping its form on such diverse phenomena as law, science, morality, art, and culture. In my view, by contrast, commodification is far from universal in capitalist society. On the contrary, it depends for its very existence, where it does exist, on zones of non-commodification. Social, ecological, and political, these non-commodified zones do not simply mirror the commodity logic, but they embody distinctive normative and ontological grammars of their own. For example, social practices oriented to reproduction as opposed to production tend to engender ideals of care, mutual responsibility, and solidarity, however hierarchical and parochial these ideals may often be. Likewise, practices oriented to polity as opposed to economy often refer to principles of democracy, public autonomy, and collective self-determination, however restrictive or exclusionary these may often be. Finally, practices associated with capitalism's background conditions in non-human nature tend to foster such values as ecological stewardship, non-domination of nature, and justice between generations, however romantic and sectarian these may sometimes be. My point, I hope it's clear, is not to idealize these non-economic normativities, but rather to register their divergence from the values associated with capitalism's economic foreground, above all values like growth, efficiency, equal exchange, individual choice, negative liberty, and meritocratic achievement. This divergence makes all the difference, I think, for how we conceptualize capitalism. Far from generating a single all-pervasive logic of reification, capitalist society is normatively differentiated, encompassing a determinate plurality of distinct but interrelated social ontologies. What happens when these collide remains to be seen, but the structure that underpins them is, I hope, already clear. Capitalism's distinctive normative topography arises from the foreground-background relations we have identified. If we aim to develop a critical theory of it, we must replace the view of capitalism as a distorted form of ethical life with a more structural institutional view, a more differentiated view. If capitalism is neither an economic system nor a distorted form of ethical life, then what is it? My answer in brief is that capitalism is best conceived as an institutionalized social order on a par, for example, with feudalism. It's a peculiarity of this capitalist order that many of its most salient social relations appear in the guise of economic relations, as I just said. But these apparently economic relations, which constitute capitalism's foreground, are enabled by and indeed feed off of other important social relations constructed as non-economic, which constitute its background. Structurally, therefore, I'm claiming it's the whole complex of background and foreground, and above all, the relations among them that constitutes capitalism. Viewed in this way as an institutionalized social order, capitalism is at once the foreground economic logic and the latter's background conditions of possibility, conditions that it simultaneously needs and tends to destabilize. Understanding capitalism in this way underscores its structural divisions, especially those institutional separations that I have mentioned. Constitutive of capitalism, I've said, is the institutional separation of economic production from social reproduction, a gendered separation that grounds specifically capitalist forms of male domination, even as it also enables capitalist exploitation of labor power, and through that, its officially sanctioned mode of accumulation. Also definitive of capitalism is the institutional separation of economy from polity, a separation that expels matters defined as economic from the political agendas of territorial states, while freeing capital to roam in a transnational no man's land where it reaps the benefits of hegemonic ordering while escaping political control. Equally fundamental to capitalism, finally, is the ontological division, pre-existing but massively intensified, between its non-human natural background and its apparently non-natural human foreground. Therefore, to speak of capitalism as an institutionalized social order premised on such separations is to suggest its non-accidental structural imbrication with gender oppression, political domination, both national and transnational, colonial and post-colonial, and ecological degradation, all in conjunction, of course, with its equally structural non-accidental foreground dynamic of labor exploitation. To speak in this way, however, is not to suggest that capitalism's institutional divisions are simply given once and for all. On the contrary, precisely where and how capitalist societies draw the line between production and reproduction, economy and polity, human and non-human nature, varies historically according to the regime of accumulation. In fact, a typology of such regimes can be constructed on this very basis. In the view I've been elaborating here, what distinguishes accumulation regimes are the ways in which they differentiate and relate capitalism's foreground and background conditions. So we can conceptualize competitive laissez-faire capitalism, state-managed monopoly capitalism, and globalizing neoliberal capitalism as three historically specific ways of demarcating economy from polity, production from reproduction, and human from non-human nature. Equally important, the precise configuration of the capitalist order at any place and time depends on politics, on the balance of social power, and on the outcome of social struggles. Far from being simply given, capitalism's institutional divisions often become foci of conflict as actors mobilize to challenge or defend the established boundaries separating economy from polity, production from reproduction, human from non-human nature. Insofar as they aim to relocate contested processes on capitalism's institutional map, capitalism's subjects draw on the normative perspectives associated with the various zones I've identified. This sort of thing is happening all around us today. For example, some opponents of neoliberalism draw on ideals of care, solidarity, and mutual responsibility associated with reproduction or community in order to oppose efforts to commodify, for example, healthcare or education. Others summon notions of stewardship of nature and justice between generations associated with ecology to militate for a tax on carbon emissions and a shift to renewable energy, or to defend communal fishing grounds. Still others invoke ideals of public autonomy associated with polity to advocate international capital controls and to extend democratic governance beyond the state. Such claims, along with the counterclaims they inevitably incite, are the very stuff of social struggle in capitalist societies, as fundamental as the class struggles over control of commodity production and distribution of surplus value that Marxists have historically privileged. These boundary struggles, as I call them, decisively shape the structure of capitalist societies. The institutional divisions established at any given time and place are best understood as provisional stabilizations of the outcome of previous struggles, as are the resulting regimes of accumulation or so-called varieties of capitalism. In general, then, boundary struggles play a constitutive role in the view of capitalism as an institutionalized social order. I'm underlining this point in part to forestall the misimpression that the view I've been elaborating is functionalist. Granted, I began by characterizing reproduction, ecology, and political power as necessary background conditions for capitalism's economic front story, stressing their functionality for commodity production, labor exploitation, and capital accumulation. But this structural functional moment does not capture the full complexity of capitalism's foreground and background relations. It coexists, rather, with another moment, which I've already hinted at, that is equally central for grasping the relations among economy, society, polity, and nature in capitalist society. And that second moment emerges from the view of the social, ecological, and political realms as reservoirs of what I've been calling, for want of a better term, non-economic normativity. This view implies that even as these non-economic orders make commodity production possible, they are not reducible to that enabling function. Far from being wholly exhausted by or entirely subservient to the dynamics of accumulation, Each of these more hidden abodes harbors its own ontological grammar of social practice and associated normative ideals. Under certain conditions, moreover, these ideals can be turned against practices associated with capital accumulation. Politically pregnant in principle, capitalism's non-economic normativities become especially salient in times of crisis. In those times, the structural divisions that normally serve to segregate the various normativities within their own institutional spheres tend to weaken. When the separations fail to hold, capitalism subjects, who live, after all, in more than one sphere, experience normative conflict. Far from bringing in ideas from the outside, they draw on capitalism's own complex and differentiated normativity to criticize it, mobilizing against the grain the multiplicity of ideals that inhabit an institutionalized social order premised on foreground-background divisions. Let's see if I can wrap this up. Let me just mention two final points that can further clarify these foreground-background relations that I'm saying are definitive of capitalist societies. The first follows from what I just said. Given the expanded view of capitalism as an institutionalized social order, it would be wrong to construe society, polity, and nature romantically as outside capitalism and as inherently opposed to it. Unfortunately, I think that romantic view is rather widely held today by a good number of left-wing thinkers and activists, including cultural feminists, deep ecologists, and neo-anarchists, as well as by some proponents of so-called plural post-growth solidarity and popular economies. Identifying care, nature, direct action, or commoning as intrinsically anti-capitalists, these currents overlook the fact that their favorite practices are not only sources of critique, but also integral parts of the capitalist order. As I noted earlier, society, polity, and nature arose concurrently with economy as the latter's others. It's only by contrast to economy that they acquire their specific character. For example, reproduction and production make a pair. Each term is co-defined by the other and makes no sense except in relation to the other. The same is true of polity, economy, and nature, human. Part and parcel of the capitalist order, none of these non-economic realms affords a wholly external standpoint that could underwrite an absolutely pure and fully radical form of critique. On the contrary, political projects that appeal to what they imagine to be capitalism's outside usually end up recycling capitalist stereotypes as they counterpose, for example, female nurturance to male aggression, spontaneous cooperation to economic calculation, nature's organicist holism to humanist individualist splitting. Historically inaccurate and conceptually problematic, these are clearly ideological oppositions. To premise one's struggles on them is not to challenge, but unwittingly to reflect the institutionalized order of capitalist society. Moreover, and this is my second final point, capitalism's foreground-background relations, as I've suggested throughout, harbor some built-in sources of social instability, which constitutes what we can call, following Marx, crisis tendencies. The nub of the matter is this. Given its inherent penchant for limitless expansion, capitalism's foreground processes of accumulation tend to destabilize the very background conditions on which they rely. We saw, of course, that capitalist production is not self-sustaining, but free rides on social reproduction, nature, and political power. At the same time, its orientation to endless accumulation threatens to destabilize its own conditions of possibility. In the case of its ecological conditions, what is at risk are the natural processes that sustain life and provide the material inputs for social provisioning. In the case of its social reproduction conditions, what is imperiled are the sociocultural processes that supply the solidary relations, affective dispositions, and value horizons that underpin social cooperation, while also furnishing the appropriately socialized and skilled human beings who constitute labor. In the case of the political conditions, what is compromised are the public powers, both national and transnational, that guarantee property rights, enforce contracts, adjudicate disputes, quell anti-capitalist rebellions, and maintain the money supply. Now here, in the language of Marxist orthodoxy, if we want to use that, are three contradictions of capitalism: the ecological, the social, and the political, which correspond to three crisis tendencies. Unlike the crisis tendencies stressed by orthodox Marxists, however, these do not stem from contradictions internal to the capitalist economy. They are grounded, rather, in contradictions between the economic system on the one hand and its background conditions of possibility on the other. That is, between economy and society, economy and nature, economy and polity. The effect, as I've noted before, is to incite a broad range of social struggles in capitalist societies, not only class struggles at the point of production, but also boundary struggles over nature, social reproduction, and political power. Responses to the crisis tendencies inherent in capitalist society, those struggles are endemic to or constitutive of our expanded view of capitalism as an institutionalized social order. To summarize, a proper account of capitalism's foreground-background relations must hold together four distinct ideas. First, capitalism's non-economic realms serve as enabling background conditions for its economy. The latter depends, for its very existence, on values and inputs from the former. Second, however, capitalism's non-economic realms have a weight and character of their own, which can, under certain circumstances, provide resources for anti-capitalist struggle. Nevertheless, and this is the third point, these realms are part and parcel of capitalist society, historically co-constituted in tandem with its economy and marked by their symbiosis with it. Finally, the capitalist order harbors a plurality of crisis tendencies, as foreground processes of accumulation tend to destabilize the very background conditions on which they rely. All four ideas are necessary for an adequate conception of the foreground-background relations that constitute capitalist society. None alone is sufficient. All must therefore somehow be thought together in an expanded understanding of capitalism as an institutionalized social order. Thank you very much for your attention.